Now, ladies and gentlemen, as Frank said, we'll hear from Mikhail Rashka, who's a senior banker at the EIB, who will give us the EIB perspective on infrastructure investment. Mikhail.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. My name is Michael Raschke, from the European Investment Bank in Luxembourg. I'm in the department responsible for private sector projects at EIB, which includes lending, mostly lending to research and development intensive corporates and to banks. Western Europe includes obviously the UK, otherwise I wouldn't be here today, also Ireland, the Benelux countries, and France. I will provide you today with an overview of EIB's activities and in particular its lending to the ICT sector between 2007 and 2012. In the light of the meeting today, I would like to highlight our activities in the broadband sector, and at the end of the presentation, I will also provide a short overview of the telecommunications market in the 27 member states. First of all, some background information on EIB. EIB is the bank of the European Union. It was founded in 58. Shareholders are the 27 member states. We are the largest multilateral development bank worldwide in terms of assets, but also in terms of lending volume. We finance ourselves on the capital markets, i.e., the support we get from the European taxpayer is in the end the equity and a guarantee for capital not yet paid in, but the funding itself, i.e., our lending activities, are financed by the capital markets. This activity is supported by a AAA rating of the bank, which is backed by our shareholders, but also by the sound credit portfolio of the institution. Next to EIB, we have a subsidiary, which is the European Investment Fund, where EIB is a majority shareholder, but nevertheless, there are also third-party shareholders. We are a provider, the EIB is a provider of senior debt. EIF is providing guarantee programs and also fund-to-fund business. As said before, we are a hybrid. We are a bank, but we are also a political institution. This implies that each of our projects we finance need to meet at least one of the described eligibility criteria, not all of them, but one. There are four headlines. First of all, increase in growth and employment, with certain sub-themes like knowledge economy, which includes our lending to broadband infrastructures. Knowledge economy means for EIB, or in the European terminology, everything which is related to support the research and development undertaken in the European Union, i.e., our lending activities cover research infrastructure like universities. This is something where we are quite active in the UK, but also lending to research and development intensive corporates and also related infrastructure like broadband, for example. We also provide lending to trans-European networks, which is the classical type of activity at EIB, i.e., motorways, high-speed train links, etc. Another eligibility criteria are competitive and secure energy, urban and rural regeneration, small and medium-sized enterprises, SMEs. This is an activity where we cooperate with financial intermediaries in the respective regional markets, i.e., in the UK, for example, within the end, all high-street banks. Another point of attention is environmental sustainability. I will not explain that in detail. Economic and social cohesion and climate action. Yeah, so we cannot finance everything. Before providing financing to a project, we would need to check in how far it meets our eligibility criteria. All this information is also available on the website, so you can have a look after that. If it comes to our activities in the ICT sector between 2007 and 2012, you see that this activity includes our lending to broadband, to ICT, RDI, satellite business, and manufacturing. The overall lending volume between 2007 and 2012 was 17 billion, or in total, 77 projects. After
a strong increase between 2007 and 2009. You see a certain dip in 2010, 2011. This is simply explained by the fact that we significantly increased our lending activity between 2007 and 2009, and due to balance sheet restrictions, we had to decrease our new lending activity in the two following years. Nevertheless, our shareholders decided in 2012 to increase EIB's capital by 10 billion, which would allow us to increase our level of activity, as you can already see in 2012. This development is backed by a strong pipeline for this year, consisting of 22 projects with an overall volume of 3.1 billion.
The next slide, unfortunately, the colors got lost for the single countries. Nevertheless, it provides you with an overview of the regional activity in the single markets. You see that the four largest regional markets contribute, i.e. Germany, Italy, Spain, and UK, contribute to more than 60% of our activities in that segment. If it comes to our activities in the broadband sector, you see qua volume a very similar picture as shown before. In total, we have provided financings in the amount of 10 billion between 2007 and 2012, consisting of 41 projects. Again, we see strong demand for 2013 with 14 projects in the pipeline with an overall amount of 2.1 billion. Frank mentioned that before. You see, if you calculate the average size of a single transaction, you see that the average size is in the range between 100 and 150 million euros. This is also due to the fact that we are a wholesale organization with 2,000 employees in Luxembourg, no regional offices. So we require a certain minimum size for a single project. Otherwise, it wouldn't be efficient for us to do the appraisal. Nevertheless, this of course does not mean that smaller projects could be bundled in a way to meet our minimum amounts. And we are not fixed, or we are not too strict in that regard. I think if you have an interesting project where we see that EIB can provide some added value, then of course we also would be happy to discuss smaller amounts. But nevertheless, we couldn't provide a financing to a single municipality in the amount of five million pounds, for example. Here are a few examples of recent fixed broadband projects in the union. You see that we have a wide range of activities. We lend to large telecom operators like Deutsche Telekom, to alternative operators like Iliad in France, but also to smaller regional projects like Rege Fiber, for example. Next to the fixed broadband, we are of course also active in the mobile network area. I think these are all known names to you. I don't need to explain that. Simply to illustrate that we have a large diversification, regional diversification with regard to the activities. To provide you with a bit of background information, not only with the figures, what we have done, two case studies. First of all, Rege Fiber. Rege Fiber is a joint venture between private investors and KPN, i.e. the telecom operator in the Netherlands. The project encompasses the financing of fiber to the home networks in the eastern part of the country. It will finally pass about 1.1 million homes. As said before, KPN acts as strategic investor, not only on the equity side, but also as a strategic partner for the rollout of the financing. Nevertheless, this is an open network with open access to third parties as well. Next to EIB, commercial banks provided financing or have provided financing in the same amount. I think this is quite risk sharing, but also with regard to the catalytic effect we would like to achieve, a good example how we see ourselves as a financing party, i.e. we do not want, we cannot provide the whole financing to a project. We are restricted to 50% of the project costs. We see ourselves as accelerator
attracting also third parties. Second financing is for Iliad. There we also provided two loans in the overall amount of 350 million. The project concerns the expansion of advanced fixed broadband telecommunication in France to provide basic broadband as well as high-speed and very high-speed broadband services. One interesting aspect is that for the second financing, the borrower has signed a shared infrastructure agreement with the incumbent operator, France Telecom. This is not a bilateral agreement. This is also signed by other parties. But this structure might provide a good model for the rollout in less densely populated areas. Just as background information, a few slides on the European telecom market. You see from this slide that the average penetration for fixed broadband in the 27 member states is in the range of 60%. I think quite an achievement. You can see in France, for the smaller countries, it's not necessarily a surprise, but France as a larger country has also a significant achievement, with a penetration rate which is in the range of 80%. I think this is an interesting slide where we could also trigger a discussion after the presentations. It shows the interdependence between the demand and the offering of broadband. And I think that's an interesting discussion. What is the trigger for the rollout? Is it simply the infrastructure to be digged into the ground? Or is it in the end something where, as a new product, where you also need to create a demand for the successful implementation? Our experience is, and also from this perspective, it would be difficult to participate in the market rollout risk of fiber projects. This is something where, based on previous experience, we would like to have a strategic partner involved who's able to sell, provide the content, because in the end, this is a product which needs to be sold by the content. And this is obviously something, a role which a financing party can play. We are talking about the overall investment requirements. Frank mentioned that before, the significant investments required. If we would like to achieve a 100% penetration rate for fast or super fast broadband coverage. Based on current estimations, only 50% of 120 million households are covered. Interesting is, of course, also in how far the large telecom operators are willing and able to invest in this market segment, requiring large capex. As three major statements, first of all, penetration rates for existing products in the European member states are rather high. There's, in the end, no further increase possible. The revenues generated out of these services are stagnating. And in order to achieve growth, at least for the large operators in the market, the strategy was to expand outside the European Union. If we take a closer view on the revenues generated in the different product areas, we see stagnating income from fixed and mobile services. Only for data and internet services, there's a slight increase visible. Looking at the capex, we see that from 2006 till 2011, the capex remained more or less stable in the range of approximately 45 billion per annum. Slightly higher amounts are invested on the fixed infrastructure, with the remaining part on mobile networks. For more information, you can take a view on our website or contact myself or my colleagues directly. Thank you very much.